Hi everybody, this is your Mandalas and Movement class for expansion and growth. We're going to start at the top of the mat, placing our hands over our heart. Take a couple of breaths here. Really trying to set our intentions for our practice, create this expansion of the heart space, openness to any wisdom that may come to us throughout the practice. So just take a few breaths here, close your eyes, really turn your attention inward. Allow yourself to come into the space. Just trying to open ourselves to expanding our creativity, expanding our awareness, and working all those energy centers that help move energy when we feel stagnant. So we're going to do a lot of stuff working in those areas. Continue to breathe. Go ahead and bring the arms up above the head, reaching up as high as you can. Then we're going to hinge at the hips into forward fold. You can bend the knees in and out, kind of bicycling them, just to kind of warm up the knees. Let your head, neck, and shoulders all come forward. And then we're going to slide the hands up the front of the body as we bring the arms back up. Reaching, press the pelvis forward and then hinge again, folding all the way back over, forward fold. We're going to create this flow, lifting up, pushing the pelvis forward, hinging at the hips, warming up the hip flexors, opening the arms up. Allowing that movement to begin to flow, dropping again down into forward fold. It's okay to bend the knees here. So what you're really trying to do is release the upper body. So grab your elbows, swing a little bit side to side. Just let go of your upper part of your body. Drop the hands forward and walk them out in front of you, and then step the feet back. We're going to take the first downward dog of the practice. Take a breath here. Again, trying to release the head from the shoulders. Hips are up high, pressing the feet back. Spreading the fingers. And then just kind of wiggle your hips from side to side a little bit. We're going to begin to flow, kind of rounding the spine as we go forward into almost a plank, but it's really just rolling the spine forward and back, warming up the shoulders. And then drop the knees down, coming into extended child's pose. Reaching out the arms in front of you, pressing your hips back towards your heels. Breathing here. Nice deep inhales and exhales. Mm. Now we're going to flip the toes, come back through downward dog and take warrior stance on the right leg. So you have that 90 degree in the front knee and palms in prayer as we press out before and in front of you and back. We're going to do this about 5 times, reaching out in front of you. Hands are together, bring it back to the heart space. So it's almost like you're pushing out in front of you. So this is also helping with the rotation of the wrist. Step back up with the foot and then we're going to switch sides. So bringing that left leg into warrior stance. And then pushing the palms out in front. It's almost like you're squeezing your hands into each other. And about 5 times. Make sure you're breathing. Then you can bring your arm all the way down, your left arm all the way down to the ground, and then open up the right arm all the way to the sky. Or if that's hard for you, you can place your elbow on your knee. But we're lifting the arm up as you look at your hand in the sky. Turn your feet forward, and then we're gonna switch to the left leg. So taking the warrior stance in the bottom part of your body, lifting up the hand to the sky. And again, you can place your elbow on your knee, or you can place your hand down on the floor, whatever feels more comfortable for you. Side angle pose. Bringing both arms in front of you and turning your feet forward. You're gonna release down into a wide-legged forward fold. Just move your hips and your body back and forth a little bit, just kind of working out any tightness you may have. And then coming all the way back up to standing, you're still facing your feet forward, and then we're gonna move into these hip circles, nice big. And it really doesn't matter the direction because we're gonna do both sides. Just make them really nice and big all the way around. This is helping to work the sacral chakra, the root chakra. The sacral chakra is known for increasing creativity and fertile energy. It's your sexual center. So if you're having any issues or feeling stagnant in those areas, it's why we're working it in this class, because we're trying to release any locked up energy for creativity. And then just taking and shaking the hips side to side, bring the feet in a little bit closer, about shoulder width, and we're going to take the hips and from side to side lift the arms up. And we're just kind of pushing them out, working out any tightness. Again, this is working those chakra centers or energy centers that help with creativity. Then let your arms come down, and we're going to kind of like free float the arms around. So I want you to just move your body, twisting side to side, whatever feels good. So if you need to move your head, move your shoulders, the height of your arms can change, move your ankles and your feet. Just allow yourself to be free. Whatever feels good on your body. Even take the elbows back. You might hear some clicks and pops from your back adjusting. And then slowly coming back into center. Take your feet a little bit wider. Bring the arms up above your head. So you're going to take the inside of your hands towards each other as you kind of do like a little mini squat. And you're just making these big circles as you bring the arms around. So it's like gathering energy. Expanding your arms and your reach so you can expand your creativity and your taking away limitations. Okay, now we're gonna alternate the hands, but you're gonna still keep the backs of the hands facing each other as you come towards the middle. Shift your hips a little bit side to side, so you're kind of making like this infinity sign with your hands. Remember to breathe. Coming back to center, we're gonna clear that space. Just bringing the hands together up and around. Back to the middle. Hands are gonna slide down the front of the legs all the way down to your ankles. Release your head, neck, and shoulders. Take a breath. It feels good to release those or decompress that spine. Bringing the hands in between your feet, and you're going to create kind of like a kickstand and a straight line from your head to your tailbone. Pull your belly button towards your spine, so you're pulling the abdomen in. And then roll your spine all the way up, opening the arms nice and wide. Open that chest up. The arms are out to the side, bringing the head and the neck open. Chest is big. Bringing the fingers forward, so you're opening and closing the hands as you round the shoulders, round the spine. Again, this is for expansion of the heart space, so you can have compassion for yourself. I know when we deal with art, we're always kind of hypercritical on what our stuff looks like, and this is to kind of give yourself compassion and allow you to be open with whatever it looks like, whatever comes out of you, whatever your art looks like. We're not judging. This is for us. So just breathing, kind of linking the breath with the movement as we round, touching the fingertips and then opening wide. Open the arms up, and then you're going to take your left arm up above your head. This is triangle pose. So you're just lifting the arm up, and then you're just going to fold in and create these big circles. I'm sorry, that was the right hand. No, that was the left hand. Around. Do this about 3 times. And then we're going to change sides. So open the arms out to the side, and then take the right arm up towards the ceiling. And always try to bring your eyes to the hand or looking up at the ceiling, and then kind of folding in and make a couple of circles. We're going to do this about 3 times, just rounding the hips all the way around. And then back up, scooting the feet back together about shoulder width or hip. Squat down, holding your hands on the top of your knees. So this is a starting point. Wiggle your hips a little bit. Maybe move from side to side. Your feet are kind of pointed outwards. And you're just trying to sink your bottom down. Now, if that's as far as you can go, I just suggest you stay there. But the next move is called Malasana, frog pose. So you drop all the way down to the floor, bringing your butt all the way down as close as you can to the mat. Hands are in prayer and your elbows on their inside of the knees. You're just trying to release your bottom down. Keep the feet flat. Take a breath. Roll back. And you're going to turn back on your mat. The soles of the feet are facing each other. This is cobbler pose, and you can push your hands on the inside of your knees or clasp your feet. Lift yourself up nice and tall, take a breath in, and then fold forward, releasing your head and neck. come back up. Bring the left foot out in front of you and the right knee is bent up. The left arm comes across on the outside of that leg, and then you're turning, looking over the shoulder, bringing your eyes all the way back, and you're trying to keep your back straight, so try not to fold over. As you breathe, you're just squeezing out. And we'll use that hand as a lever or that arm. Just switching sides, so bringing that left knee up now, turning and looking over that shoulder. Make sure you continue to breathe. Releasing back to the middle. You're gonna come on top of your knees, so you're sitting on your feet. And this next section is about just moving forward and back. So this is from the abdomen down to the hips, more like the pelvic region. And you're just pumping energy through that space. So just back and forth, and your breathing kind of matches that movement. It may feel weird at first. And this might be because you need to move energy in this area, or you're just not used to moving that part of your body. Just try to feel it out. Close your eyes. Do what you can. These practices are always about doing the best you can with how your body feels. This is always also really great for like pelvic health when you're trying to tighten, help with pelvic prolapse or anything going down in the lower part of the abdomen, digestion, constipation. So now we're moving up. So like below the breast, but above the pelvis. This one's a little bit harder, but just focuses on like kind of pumping your diaphragm. Let's just think of it like that. So moving that area back and forth, and trying to keep the other parts as still as possible. Well, these are affecting the chakras. So the first one was for the lower chakras, the root and the sacral. This is for the solar plexus, which is your self-worth and your inner sun. This is how you connect with yourself and the way you think about yourself. Remember to breathe with this. Don't try to hold your breath. And you don't have to go as fast as I do. You can go at your own speed. We're just bringing awareness to the area and movement. All right, now moving up from like the breast or the chest up to the neck. Again, these might feel weird, but close your eyes and just trying to feel where the movement is happening and try to isolate those areas. For this one, you may think about just moving the shoulders back and forth or pressing the chest through the shoulders. This is for the heart chakra, the heart center, creating compassion. Or really, these are all just about balancing and moving energy. So focusing on the love, self-love that we have, and creating compassion for ourselves. Interlace the fingers and place the hands behind the head. Press the elbows back, so squeeze the shoulder blades. release the hands, and then you can sit down regular Indian style. And the next thing we're going to do is bring the hands behind the back, open the chest again, lift the head and the neck back. And if you want to and you're more flexible than me, my shoulders are very tight, and I'm trying to prevent some injuries from an injury. It's just started to heal, so I'm being very careful. But you can lift your arms back if that feels better for you too. Just really depends on how flexible you are. Releasing those arms and moving into stir the bowl. So it's like your torso is the spoon and your pelvic region is the bowl, and you're just doing circles. Doesn't matter the direction, you're gonna go both ways. This is also really good for like digestion, especially if you're constipated or feeling backed up. So this kind of helps move the guts around. Good for gas, releasing gas. But we're also working on those lower chakras again. Switch to the other side, so make sure you get both directions. Always remembering to breathe. Begin to roll the shoulders back and really just move the shoulders any way you want to. You can alternate lifting side to side or just roll back, round and push forward. Just loosen the shoulders up, whatever feels good. And now moving into some neck rolls. Do these nice and slow, rolling around. If you need to hang out in a certain spot, that's fine. It's just whatever feels good. Nice, slow, all the way around. All right. So we're going to lay down on our backs, put your feet together, knees together, and then we're windshield wipering our legs, our knees from side to side. Hands are flat, back is flat. You're really just kind of rocking yourself, coming into the last part of the class. Working out any tension or leftover tightness that you haven't worked out from the class. Slowing it down. Breathing. Cross your right foot over your left knee and roll your hips over towards the left. You're gonna open up the right arm and bring the head and neck towards the right, and just situate your shoulders so they're as flat as possible. And you can use your left hand to hold that knee down if you need to. Make sure to take a good, deep, long breath. And then we're just going to switch sides. So bringing that left foot over the right knee and bringing the legs or hips and knees over to the right side. Doing the same thing. So you're adjusting your shoulders, looking your head to the left, bringing awareness down to the hips. Taking a nice deep inhale and exhale. releasing anything that feels tight. Just starting to feel your body relax as we're moving closer to meditation. Roll back to where your back is flat. Left foot comes down, right knee comes up. And we're just alternating knees, so squeezing as you bring it in, and then taking that other leg out nice and long. Just breathing nice and easy. This is very relaxing. Nothing's pushed or forced. Everything today is kind of at your own pace. Let's plant the feet down and bring your hips up for bridge. These are bridge pulses. So again, you're working the lower chakras. Just pushing up and down. So bringing your hips up towards the ceiling, squeezing as you come up. Again, these are nice and easy. You don't have to be moving as fast as I am. Just move the way your body wants to move. And breathe. Hold the last one. Take a breath here. Release down and then pull your knees all the way back in towards your chest. Nice big squeeze. Now release everything out. Long legs, arms are above. It's like somebody's pulling you from both sides, from your ankles, from your arms. Couple of breaths here. We made it to the end of the class. Start to even out your breath and prepare yourself for meditation. So grab an eye pillow, and then you're gonna find whatever is a comfortable position for you to be laying down in. Let's continue to take a few nice deep inhales and exhales as we slowly start to let our bodies come to this nice, relaxing position. Allow all your body parts to become heavy, starting at your head. And as you breathe, you're just letting that relaxation continue down your body. Letting your shoulders go, letting your hands fall open and free, letting your hips be heavy on the floor against the mat, allowing that to go all the way down, down to your feet, where your heels are gently resting on the mat. Each breath that you take, you're just continuing that relaxation. You continue to follow my voice as all the sounds that you hear externally just turn into a part of your meditation. And all you hear are the sounds and tones of my voice. Your body is beginning to settle and you feel heavy all over your body. Your breathing has become normal and you feel the breath move with ease in and out of your lungs as you continue to let go further and further, deeper and deeper. I want you to bring your awareness to your third eye, that space just between your eyes. Just notice, and bringing awareness to this space will allow the energy to move. You can even imagine your breath moving in and out of this space like a spout. So for the next few breaths, I want you to just watch and move the breath like a spout out of your third eye space. Watching and filling. As we breathe, continuing to take ourselves into this peaceful stillness. And as you bring your awareness to your third eye, we're looking to open and expand our connection with our highest self, our intuition, creativity. This expansion and connection is happening after a big change in our lives, and we're needing to shed layers in order to create space for our soul's expansion. Our spirit is craving to make, create, to let go of limitations, self-imposed limitations that we put on ourselves, judgments that we place on ourselves. Connect with the divine wisdom within you that also guides you from the ethers, any spirit guides, ascended masters, past loved ones, your highest self. Allow your crown chakra to open and draw that wisdom down through your body. Continuing to breathe, letting go, not trying to control anything. We go through several versions of ourselves throughout our lifetime, a spiritual transformation. As we go through these versions of ourselves, we must learn to grow and expand. But first, we must shed these unused layers of our psyches and ourselves that no longer serve us at our highest alignment. I'd like you to think about your most recent change that has affected you. Taking in all the aspects of this change, allow those thoughts to come in without judgment. Allow yourself to feel all the feelings, uncomfortable, joyful, stressful, happy, and fearful. I want you to breathe in this space. Allow the thoughts to come. Just taking in and noticing Okay, now, take these things that you feel are negative or in a lower vibration. Anything that feels heavy and anything that you feel you're in need of releasing, and allow those things to be released. Continuing to breathe. Now we're ready to expand and connect. Okay, good. Now that you have created space, we're going to fill that space with a newer version of the things to come. We will open ourselves to the wisdom and guidance to allow for the higher alignment of all the good, putting ourselves in a place of success and flow. Now, for the next few moments, I want you to think about all your goals for about the next 6 months or so. These are things that you need to learn, accomplish, practice, or do. Allow these thoughts, feelings, struggles, discomforts, joys, and overall feelings of accomplishment that will come with these things. Breathing into this space for the next few moments, allow those to come without judgment. Allow yourself to be open to opportunity, to new beginnings, to connection. As you allow yourself to be open, take a moment to see through your inner eye, your third eye, what colors are being shown, how you feel. Allow yourself to just watch behind your mind's eye, creating these new layers of yourself as you move forward. Starting to come back to ourselves. Let's start to bring ourselves back to our physical body. Fingers, toes, head, hips. Slowly working yourself back into your body, taking a few breaths in and out. And then slowly start to come back to your body. Coming back with a new version of yourself and new layers. Revived and rejuvenated. The awesome thing about what we're going to do next is we get to create a beautiful piece of artwork. What you'll need is a sheet of watercolor paper, brushes, watercolor paints, black markers with different size tips on it, and a couple of cups of water. I was experimenting with Himalayan salt to change the texture of the watercolors. You can do that. And then there's just a rag over there to wipe my brush off because it gets kind of wet. So what I did is I kind of created this rainbow effect, just kind of drawing these, or not drawing, painting these colors across the paper, but you don't have to follow what I'm doing. You can, if you've seen something different within your meditation, then you can just place those in circles or whatever shapes, however you want to put the paints on there, just go with your creative mind. You do have to wet the paper a little bit, and so this kind of makes the paper crinkly and wavy, so I just took a couple of yoga blocks and a couple of jars of honey and let it dry for a while it was drying. I kind of just thought about what I had seen in my meditations, what I'm trying to do for the next several months, trying to really focus on a mantra or something to kind of keep me focused on my goals at hand. And that's kind of the whole purpose of these classes, is to keep us on track, to help us create and keep our creativity, not become stagnant in those times whenever we feel stuck. And you know, experimenting, and don't be too judgmental on yourself. This is you know, your artwork. You're not trying to sell this thing, or this is really self-exploration and kind of seeing what and how you feel. So then I wanted to do, instead of starting off in the middle of the paper, I went from the corners because I thought I could, drawing freehand, really just go with the flow. And I tried not to judge too much about like the shapes and stuff that I was doing. So just like you create those layers of yourself and those skills, and you practice the things that you want to do, I just kind of continued on, and I didn't worry about if this was a perfect shape or did it look, you know, exactly like the other one. There's a lot of differences and several mistakes in here, but I think the overall, you know, the outcome of this project was awesome. It was really fun to do, and it allowed me to like kind of check out for a little bit and just free flow and find this, like, you know, flow state. And I'm really kind of excited to see what you guys created. So I hope you guys share your pictures of your mandalas. And even though this is kind of coming out a little bit later and we're still gaining people on the site and on the Patreon and people who are actually doing the classes, I still want to see if you do these after I post the classes. So looking forward to talking to you guys and communicating, seeing your artwork. Until next time, be love and namaste.
the depression, because I suppose I was born a fighter, but a fighter in a rather different way from getting out there and being aggressive, because I don't think that works. You've just got to be calm and tell stories and try and get people to change from within. I'm Jane Goodall, and this is the Hopecast. Welcome to the first episode of the Hopecast. This podcast has been some time in the making, and I'm so excited for us to have this space to feel a sense of shared hope for our planet. This season, I'm excited to introduce you to people who inspire me with their work in conservation. I'll be talking to friends, old and new, getting diverse perspectives on what it's going to take for us to help heal some of the damage that's been done. But for this first episode, it's just you and me. I'll be sharing some of my own story with you while also setting the stage for episodes to come. So why is this called the Hopecast? Because I believe in the power of hope. I believe hope is what spurs us into action, and I do believe in the indomitable human spirit. When I first was what I call grounded in the UK at the beginning of lockdown, I was frustrated and angry, and I was used to travelling 300 days a year around the world and talking to people, packed auditoriums, you know, up to 10, 15,000 people. And suddenly now I'm stuck here. And then I thought, well, there's not much point being angry and frustrated. So we decided to build a virtual Jane. And that virtual Jane has managed to reach millions more people in many more countries than if I'd been doing my normal tours. And apparently I've done fairly well, because people say that they are moved, they do get the message loud and clear. I think the success of the podcast, or Hopecast, is extending the audience to whom I can try and bring a message of hope, because we're living through such dark times. I mean, in every way you look, the climate, the politics, it's pretty grim. And if people lose hope, then we may as well give up, because if you don't have hope, what's the point? Eat, drink, and be merry, but tomorrow we die. But it's that hope, I think, that's enabled us humans to emerge from the days when surely laboring over making a stone tool, a lot of work. There must have been hope that this stone tool would help you find your meal for the evening. You're hunting dangerous big animals. There must have been hope that you would succeed or you would give up. So I think hope has been a part of our human evolution, a force that's pushed us to where we are today. But because there is so much darkness in the world now, it's more important than ever to try and keep that flame of hope alive, especially for young people. I'm hoping that podcasts, along with the other things I'm doing virtually, can give an extra little energy and hope to the people listening. If one wants to reach people, if one wants to change attitudes, you have to reach the heart. You can reach the heart by telling stories, not by arguing with people's intellects, especially if you're talking to the old guys who are head CEOs of so many corporations and in government. They're not going to really want to change the way they feel if somebody like me is talking to them. But if I can reach the heart, you know, the very best way for people to change is from within and not because they're pressured from outside. That may happen, but it's not my way. People often ask me, where did I get my ability to tell stories? And I think it was my Welsh ancestry, because my maternal grandfather and all that branch of the family came from the north of Wales. And the Welsh are known for their storytelling, their music, their sense of fun. So I'm very grateful for that Welsh branch of my family. Actually, I'm speaking from the house I grew up in. My mother brought me and my sister here at the start of World War II. I was 5 years old, and ever since, this has been home. So the books behind me, many of them are books I read as a child. When I was growing up as a child, an awful lot of that childhood was during World War II. And I'm actually glad I grew up in those war years, because I learned to take nothing for granted. Food was rationed, clothes were rationed, petrol was rationed, everything was rationed. And we got, I think it was one square of chocolate a week. We valued every single thing that we had. And we knew that people could die, people were dying. I lost relatives in the war and friends in the war. But we got through the war. And I think the reason we got through the war was Winston Churchill. And he made mistakes, but it was his speeches that gave us hope. You know, he was basically saying what I'm always saying, we can do it. If we get together, we can do it. We mustn't give in. We must stand up strong. We must believe that we can do it. And so we got through the war. And then, you know, there have been other horrors like the Cold War, the threat of nuclear power, which tragically has come back. I never thought it could. And we've been through the terrible wars in different parts of the world. And, you know, I've seen so much change. I've seen advances in technology, from being with no television to having some of this incredible new technology that's enabling me to reach out to people around the world. Just by sitting in my old home, my current home, sitting here and reaching people with a message. And actually, I'm able to reach far more people, millions more people, sitting here with a message of hope. So helping people realize that every day they live, they make some impact on the planet, and they can choose what sort of impact that they make. Realizing that we need to alleviate poverty, because if you're really poor, you're going to cut down the last tree, you're going to fish the last fish, because you've got to survive. And we do have to bring into the political agenda the problem of the fact that human populations and their livestock are growing. So if we carry on with business as usual, then what's going to happen? That's one silver lining of this awful pandemic. People are beginning to realize we need a different relationship with the natural world, a new, more sustainable way of living in harmony with nature instead of attacking nature as we have been doing for so long. One of the problems that we face today is that we are bombarded every day by terrible news. If we open a newspaper, if we listen to the radio, grim, grim news. It's political, it's social, and it's environmental. Very easily people are giving up hope, because they just feel that they're up against such powerful forces. And I almost would say forces of evil. How do we counteract that? I think the way we can counteract it is, during my long life, my 86 years on this planet, I have met the most extraordinary people. And yes, we're in the middle of the sixth great extinction, but I've actually met the people and the animals who were on the brink of extinction who've been given another chance. I've met the botanists who are passionate about keeping the biodiversity of our plant life alive. I've met the people studying insects who realize the importance of keeping the insect biodiversity alive, because we depend on it. We depend on the plants and the insects. also sharing the good news stories. And I'm always saying, every time I talk to the press, I say, you have to share the bad news, but please give more time for the positive, to help people understand what they can do, what they're capable of, what we are capable of, if we care enough. Sharing these stories of people and nature, we should fill people with hope, because we can do it if we will. We can regenerate nature in a place where we've destroyed it. We can rescue an animal species if we put enough effort and love and money behind it. We can regenerate forests, we can regenerate woodlands, we can rewild. In Britain, the beavers are coming back, and they are changing the land so that the flooding that was so terrible and costing so much money and causing people to lose their houses, now, because the beavers have put the land back to how it used to be, the flooding is completely reduced. We have now destroyed about one half, 50% of all the forests that once covered the globe. And as we destroy them, all this carbon is released back into the atmosphere. And the forests, particularly the rainforests, are the great reserves for biodiversity, different animal species, plant species. It's so rich in the rainforests. It's also where the chimpanzees live. Well, my career began with learning about chimpanzees. And so, obviously, we start off, you can't protect chimpanzees unless you protect their habitat, which happens to be the forest. Unfortunately, if you protect the forest, then you're protecting all the other animals and plants that make up this web of life, this amazing tapestry of life that we find in the rainforest. When we plant trees in a forest, many things happen. The trees clean the air, they filter out carbon particles, make it easier to breathe. They encourage nature to come back. People can hear birdsong again. And it turns out that people actually need green areas. And when you green an area of high crime, it's been shown, there was a big study done in Chicago, crime levels drop compared to areas that weren't green. And the tragedy is that if you look in most cities today, you find the affluent communities have lots of trees. But the deprived areas in America, particularly where people of color live, they don't have many trees. But once you put the trees there, then mental and physical health improves. The cost of healthcare drops. Fighting some of the problems that we have created on this planet, like climate change, for example, or discrimination or prejudice, is something every single one of us can do something about. I think that so many people haven't had the right education. I think that environmental education and information about who animals really are should be part of every school curriculum. And I think that it's the young people now who give me the most hope, because when they understand the problems, when they are listened to, when they're empowered to take action, that's why our Roots and Shoots program is spreading so fast. It's in more than 65 countries now, and it's young people of all ages. And it's my greatest reason for hope, because they are changing the world every day. I would like to work to save every animal species. I can't. The Jane Goodall Institute, you know, we have to concentrate on great apes and forests. Through the Roots and Shoots groups, I've got groups that care about turtles, groups that care about octopuses. Name an animal species, and I bet you somewhere there is a group passionate about saving them, spreading awareness about them, raising money for the cause. And this is really inspiring. I definitely hope that out of this Hopecast, people will realize that they have a role to play, that every individual makes a difference every single day, and we get to choose what sort of difference we make. I often talk about the reason for hope being the indomitable human spirit, that people who tackle what seems impossible and won't give up, and that every single one of us has that indomitable spirit. people don't always realize it. They don't let it grow. They don't let it out. They're nervous. They're afraid. They feel helpless and hopeless. So it's terribly important, and I hope that people listening to these podcasts will realize what they as individuals can do. And though it may not seem much, if you have the cumulative effect of millions, maybe billions of people making ethical choices every day and what they buy, how is it made, did it harm the environment, was it cruel to animals, is it cheap because of child slave labor or sweatshops or inequitable wages? And if the answer is yes, don't buy it, because consumer pressure does make a difference. There are many companies that are changing because of consumer pressure. That's what's important, that people feel empowered and that their lives do matter. Feel hopeful and inspired to act with the Jane Goodall Hopecast by subscribing on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Stitcher, Google Podcasts, and anywhere podcasts are found. I'm your host, Jane Goodall. The Jane Goodall Hopecast is produced by the Jane Goodall Institute. Our production partner is Frequency Media. Michelle Corey is our executive producer. Inar Garpusha is our producer. And Matthew Ernest Finner is our editor and sound designer. Our music is composed and performed by Ruth Mendelssohn, with additional violin tracks from Angie Shearer. Sound design and music composition for the Conservation Chorus is by Matthew Ernest Finner.
Jane Goodall and the Jane Goodall Institute on social at facebook.com/Jane Goodall and at Jane Goodall INST on Twitter and Instagram. Make sure to share about the Hopecast, tagging JGI and hashtag Hopecast for a chance to be featured. To learn more about Jane and JGI, visit janegoodall.org and support our work at janegoodall.org/donate. The Hopecast is a movement of hope turned into action, fueled by each of you. Become an official Hopecaster and support the podcast, visit janegoodall.org/Hopecaster.
My maternal grandfather, sadly I never met him because he died before I was born. He was a congregational minister and he had three brothers. They came from North Wales, which is the mountainous, beautiful area. I remember my mother telling me that when they were young, they used to go with him, and he indomitable spirit came from my mother's side of the family.
There's so many ways we can say Clara.
What is that?
I just want people to find empathy for all the species we share. True nature bounce back. Earth is pretty special. Jane Goodall made me believe in my mother.
She devoted her life to this.
What is your greatest reason for hope? I'm Jane Goodall, and this is the Hopecast. Today, I'm excited to share with you a chat I had with one of my favorite people on the planet, Dave Matthews, or David as I call him. I've known David for years and years, and what many people don't know is that apart from being an iconic musician and singer, David is an avid wildlife lover and conservationist. He often works to support conservation organizations as well as animal sanctuaries and shares my firm belief that there must be more empathy in science. I hope you enjoy this hopeful conversation with Dave Matthews. David, we first met in New York, right?
We were in New York. It's one of those things that I will never forget. It was a little bit of a frustrating day for me. It was that Live Aid concert. I guess what frustrated me was it seemed like, although it was singing about the environment and it was promoting responsibility and promoting us to be more aware of the state of our planet, it was excessive and people were flying in on private planes and it felt the opposite. And then I saw you. When I saw you, I thought, well, today is worth it. And I'm not sure how long it took me to wipe the tear from my eyes and embrace you, because you are one of my heroes from a very young age and one of my inspirations. And my father also was a mad fan, and my mother, we're all mad fans, but I feel a particular love and attraction to you and all your work and gratitude for you. And so seeing you in the flesh just made me so excited. So, but I do remember that we embraced. And then I remember that when you went in front of the crowd of 60,000 people at Giant Stadium, right? That's where we first met. You walked out in front of all those people and more or less said, I'm not accustomed to speaking to so many people, so I will just greet you as a chimpanzee would greet a stranger. And you proceeded to greet the crowd, and I have never heard an ovation like that in my life. The goosebumps all over my body just to be near that and to be in the presence of that. So I will never, ever forget the day I met you and the day I saw you rock the house of 65,000 people at Giant Stadium.
Well, you know, David, I'll never forget it either. And it was just fantastic to see you there. And I think I spoke first, and I suppose people are now wondering how I greeted the crowd, so I better demonstrate first, which is me, Jane. Yeah, yes, like that. I don't know if you know how terrified I was. I was absolutely terrified. And you know, all my friends around the world were waiting to watch. I don't know if you ever knew this, but I was bumped off the airwaves by Madonna.
I heard about it afterwards, years later, I think. It was one of the most powerful moments of my life, just to see that many people have their hearts opened by you.
And since that time, we've been on quite a great journey together, haven't we?
We've had so many amazing experiences. Like, you and I have spent time together, and I've been with you and followed you to places that have changed my life and given me hope, and you always have brought hope to me, just like you bring hope to millions of people around the world. And also, you inspire us to action, because that's what we need, not only to be hopeful, but also to take action to make our hope something that's real. And I watch you from afar, and I also appreciate thinking of you when I feel overwhelmed by the greed that seems to consume all common sense in the world.
You grew up in South Africa, right?
Sort of, but I was born there, and in America, my father was a scientist, and so we came to the States when I was little, and then we went back to South Africa, so I sort of back and forth my whole life. were living in close to rural suburbs outside New York. I remember my dad would set up a bird hide, and he would sit in there for hours on Sunday when he wasn't at work, and you know, he would let us join him, and he had to be very quiet. And we would go on camping trips, and we would hike, and you know, I'm sure I was reluctant and whining, but my memory of it is much more beautiful than that. And I think my love of wild places came from just being raised in it. And, you know, the time we spent in South Africa when I was young, and then when we moved back there after my father passed away when I was 12, in the late 70s, then we also continued to spend time visiting wild places there, and South Africa and Botswana, and just grew up loving being in places that weren't too changed by human activity. But of course, the older I got, the more I realized that any of those places were not what they once had been, and you know, not nearly to the extent that you have. But realizing as I grew older that these precious few places that are left on the planet are under attack, and so it mobilized me in a way to make me think that whatever success I have, I should somehow devote to that side of the fight for our future and for our children. Because without a healthy, vibrant, varied, and embraced and resilient planet, then we have no future. There's no human being surviving a dead planet.
You know, when I first went to Africa, it was in 1957. Where were you then?
In 1957, I was 10 years from landing on Earth.
That's right, we were 10 years pre-birth. And, you know, when I first went to Kenya in 1957, animals everywhere. When I got to Olduvai Gorge on the Serengeti, animals everywhere. When I first got to Gombe, where I'd studied the chimps, Gombe was part of a forest that went right across to the West African coast. And there were buffaloes, and there were leopards, and outside the park were lions, and now they're gone. All gone. And Gombe became a little island of forest surrounded by bare hills. So I've lived 86 years on this planet. I've seen the change. When I was little, I used to set my alarm to hear the dawn chorus of the birds. Now there's a few species left, but mostly they're gone. If you opened your window at night, the room was full of moths and other insects. Now I feel really excited if a moth comes in, one moth. And if I'm out sitting in the garden and I get bitten by a mosquito, I'm excited because we pesticided them and fertilized them away. We're harming this planet.
Yeah, at such a rate, and also because our appetite is so insatiable. In just a few decades, I believe livestock, like pigs and cows mostly, are about 60% of the animal population on the planet.
And a lot of our factory farms, many diseases arise from these horrible, cruel, and unhygienic conditions.
It's such a deadly process that we have of raising animals, because the food system that we have is all about profit. And it's not about the quality of food, and it's not about the health of the planet, it's about profit. And if that's all we think of, then you use these techniques that can drive the money very quickly into the hands of a few people rather than spread over a large amount of people that will care for the earth. These factories are exactly the opposite of life. It's a killing machine that is unhealthy on so many levels. What it produces for us for human consumption is poisonous. It's poisonous meat that's grown in a poisonous environment and fed poisonous food that's grown in a poisonous environment. And there's this wonderful documentary about soil health, a relationship to the one thing that sustains us, which is planet Earth. And that if we behave like a cancer, we will kill it and it will kill us by doing it. But if we behave like an organ, or like we're part of it, or you know, we're a limb of it, we're an example of it, if we behave that way and we work in balance with it and embrace the healthy planet, we can turn this all around. And that's the part that is so important. important and that you've taught me is that we have to work to turn this around so that we can live and thrive on a healthy planet.
You know, when I first went to Cambridge University to get the PhD, after being with the chimpanzees 2 years, many of the professors told me I'd done everything wrong. I could not talk about chimpanzee personality, mind, or emotion. Those were unique to us, I was told. But I had a wonderful teacher when I was a child. I don't know if you had such a teacher, but mine was my dog. And because of him, I knew the professors were wrong, but not the only beings on the planet with personality, mind, and above all, feelings of happiness, sadness, fear, despair. And so when you think of these factory farms, every single one of those animals has a personality, has a right to its life, feels fear and depression, and many of them can predict the death. I mean, pigs are as intelligent as dogs.
And when we talk about the relationship between animals and emotional connections that we have with animals, but also that animals have with each other, and when we talk about it in a scientific way, it was your work that broke that seal, because prior to the work you did, people said, no, we are the only emotional animals. You can't talk, scientists poo-pooed anything like that. It was absurd that any condition